Hi there folks, in today's demonstration I'm going to show you how you can trigger a flow from a SharePoint site via a button. So I've got two particular demos, one that will allow that flow to run in the context of the flow owner, where in this case we'll click on a button and we'll be able to download a file from a SharePoint site. The second is all about embedding a Power App into your SharePoint site, which will then allow you to run the flow in the context of the user. And in this particular scenario, it's all about recording to your learning log. So if you've got pages across multiple SharePoint sites where you want the end user to be able to record the time and the pages that they visited, then you can use this solution potentially to record that against their professional development. As a quick demo, you can see on screen right now, I have a button. If I press that, it's triggering a flow and downloading the licensing guide. On my second page, you can see I have a Power App, of which there's a button to record my learning. Currently, we have 7 minutes and 40 seconds on screen. If I record my learning and jump across into my learning log and quickly do a refresh, we can see that the time spent on that page has now been recorded. So if that's something that interests you, please make sure you watch on. If you haven't already, make sure you like and subscribe. And without further ado, let's jump into the demonstration. So I'm going to start things off on my training and development site, which is a SharePoint site. And I have 3 pages here for training materials, the data loss prevention, the Power Platform material, and the Power Automate. And it's at the bottom of these pages that I'd like to be able to insert a button so that the user can trigger a flow. Now that flow can either run in the context of the owner of the flow, in which case you can use an HTTP trigger, and I'll show you that first, or you can have the flow run in the context of the user that's actually on this particular SharePoint page. And it's there that I'm going to show you how we can embed a Power App with a flow button. So if we look at the first example, which is an HTTP triggered flow, if I open up my pre-built flow here, you can see I've used the when an HTTP request is received. And in my compose, I have an expression here which will retrieve a secret value that I'm going to post across into the flow. The response is HTML, so you can see the contents of an HTML page. And so when I trigger this flow using the URL that's part of the trigger here at the top, which I'll now go ahead and copy, I'll pass across a secret value, and then that value will display on the response, which is a page that's returned back to the browser. So if I jump back into SharePoint, I can go into Edit, and I'm going to add in the part for a button. So I'll click on the plus here, search for the button web part that we can see there, go into the Edit web part, and then I can add in a link. Now that link has been copied and pasted from the trigger of the flow that I just showed you. And if I use an ampersand, so paying close attention to the right hand side, I can then attach a secret value and insert, for instance, Damo Bird 365. And if I go ahead and republish that, not only will I get a button on my SharePoint page, when I trigger it in response, I will get back a website or a web page, and you can see that the parameter returned in that web page is Damo Bird 365. If I was to go back into this SharePoint site, go into Edit, go and find that button, go into Edit again, and then jump to the end of that URL where we currently will see Damo Bird 365. If I change that to Easter Halls, I'll republish that, and when I run the button this time, if we look at the response, you can see the parameter of Easter Halls has been returned. And if we look at the flow and go into the history, look at the trigger, open up the raw outputs, we can see the secret value that's been passed into my flow. And so, of course, we can pass multiple parameters, but for my particular scenario, which is based on training, being able to record the fact that a particular user has been on a particular page, if you give all of your pages unique values, you can pass that as part of the configuration using the parameter in the URL. So that first demonstration uses a flow with an HTTP trigger, which of course is premium. It runs in the context of the flow owner. So if you're looking to write data to another data source, then it would be written as that flow owner and not the user that pressed the button. But this particular scenario might work if you want to be able to enable users to download files, for instance. So what if I did want to enable the user to download a file or a series of files based on the page that they're currently browsing? Well, if I jump onto my SharePoint site, you'll see that I've downloaded the recent licensing guide, put that in the general folder of my SharePoint site. And if I jump back onto my flow, we can go into edit and I'll get the file content for that particular file. So I'll go and add a new action. We'll go and get to file content based on path. And if we add in all the details, select the file. And if we open up the response here, we can change the content type to application/PDF, and then the body will now become the file content that we get from the get file content using path. So if I go ahead and save that, and if I jump across onto my page again on SharePoint, hit that button, you'll see that we now download that Power Platform licensing guide that was on my SharePoint site. Now, of course, you could use some logic to determine based on the parameter that's passed to that URL what file is downloaded, but equally you could have some logic in there that compresses a selection of files based on the site page that you're on and downloads them to the end user. If that's something you'd like to see more of, let me know in the comments below. So the next part of my demonstration is to show you how to embed a Power App and how we're going to build that Power App so that it will allow the user to click that button based on their own credentials running as the end user. And for that, we're going to start in Power Apps with a blank app. I'll select the blank canvas and I'll give my app a name, in this case, Run from SharePoint. So with our blank canvas now loaded, there's several controls that I'd like to add, the first of which is a timer, because I'd like a timer to start upon a user arriving on the SharePoint page. It'd be pretty useful to be able to detect how long they've spent on that page. So one of the first parameters I'd like to change for this particular control is the duration. It's currently set at 60,000 milliseconds, which is 60 seconds. I would like to make the maximum amount of time that can be recorded as 60 minutes. So rather than adjust that, I'm going to multiply it by 60. So you'll see there I put 60 times 60,000. The next parameter is to enable the auto start. So as soon as this app is started on the page, the timer will begin. I'm also going to turn off the auto pause, and with a display mode, I'm going to set it to view, and that will prevent the end user from accidentally or intentionally clicking on that timer and stopping it. With that now in place, I'm going to search for a button, and we'll add that button on screen here. And the purpose of this button, if we quickly double click, we can rename it, is to record the learning. We'll just go ahead and adjust the size. And so when the end user clicks on that button, it's going to trigger our flow, which will then be able to record not only who they are, but also the amount of time that they spent on this particular page. Now, you could pretty much get away with these two buttons or two controls, but I'm also going to add in a couple of labels, and that will help us with some of the debugging. Now, if I insert a text label, and just make that slightly bigger, I'm going to add in the expression user, open close brackets, dot email, and that'll allow us to see who this app is running in the context of. So you'll see at the moment it's running as my Damien account, and we'll run this as another user shortly. So the next thing I'm going to do is to record the secret value that's passed across into our Power App directly from the URL in the browser or from the button. And so I'll copy this label and we'll paste it in here. And this will give us another label, again, purely for testing. If we go into the text, we can type in the word param, followed by open and close brackets, some double quotes, and then the name of that parameter. So this, the parameter I was passing in the first flow was called secret value. We'll stick with that. But what I'm ultimately trying to demonstrate here is that we are going to give each of our pages a unique reference to ourselves so that we can pass those values across into our data source, and then we can record not only who the user is on that page, but what page they're currently browsing based on that value that we pass. This will allow us to just demonstrate, and of course we don't need these values for the real demo. Now at this point, if we're looking to write data to a data source, record the time spent, the site, etc., we could get away with just writing directly to the data source, doing a patch or using a form. But I thought about using Power Automate because it gives us the ability to then send adaptive cards, send emails, all sorts of things. So I'm going to go ahead and insert a brand new flow. We'll go to the Power Automate button here on the left hand side. We'll create a new flow and we'll create from blank. And at the moment, you're always given this legacy trigger. I would like to delete that, filter on Power Apps, and insert the Power Apps version 2 trigger. Now I'm going to have three different inputs into this flow. The first is going to be the page, i.e. the secret value that we pass across. Then I want to have a note of who that user is based on an email address. And then finally, I would like to know how much time was spent based on that timer that we've got running when they land on our Power App. The next step is going to be to write to a data source. Now I have chosen to use a SharePoint list. You could of course use Dataverse, but if we go to create item, and if I pick my list that I know is on my training and development site, I'll go to the list name, which is training development log, and you'll see that I've got three parameters. I have the title, the claims, and the time spent. So the title is based on the page, that secret value that I'm going to pass. The user is based on the email address, so I can enter a custom value here and select user. And the time spent is based on the time spent parameter that I'll pass across when that flow is triggered. But I'm going to go ahead, give this flow a name, and then we'll save it. So we'll call that run from SharePoint and save and then close. So with the flow now attached to our Power App, we can click on that record learning button, and on the on select value, we can run that Power App. And you'll see that as I type in run from SharePoint, which is the name of my flow on the left-hand side, the clever autocomplete gives me the name of the flow for, with the .run command, and it's asking for the three parameters. So the order of the parameters are based on our secret value. So I can type in param and then secret value in the double quotes. We could of course set this into a variable when the app launches. Then I want to pass in the email address of the user that's currently using this app, which will be user.email. And of course, again, that could be a variable. And then finally, we want to pass the timer value. So if I type in timer.1 and then value, that will grab the value from the timer at that particular time. But I know there's a bit of formatting that needs to be done too. So with that, at the front of the expression, I'm going to type in text, open bracket, and then time. And with time, you have the hours, minutes, and seconds. So I'm going to always return seconds. We'll put in 0 for the hour, 0 for the minutes, and then the timer value divided by 1000 because it's in milliseconds. And then we can specify the actual format. So we'll go with hours, minutes, and seconds, and get our lovely text control or text function to reformat that data for us. So a couple of closing brackets and that's all we need. So if I go ahead and hit play, the timer, as you can see, will start running. And if I was to hit the record learning, it would attempt to write to the data source. But at the moment, we don't have the secret value being passed, so I'd expect it to fail. So I'll hit the record learning and you can see there, it's saying that it has failed. But with that all set up, if we save and then publish this solution, we can get the URL for this particular app and then we can embed it into one of our pages. So by clicking on back, I can see the app that I created earlier. I can go into the details. I can grab the URL of that particular app. And if I jump back onto my SharePoint site, I'll go into the Power Platform Learning page, into Edit, scroll to the bottom, insert the web part for Power Apps, with no space, bizarrely. And with that, you can see that I can paste in the URL. At the end of it, like the first demo, I can type in secret value, and we can set that to be Power Apps Learning. And of course, you can create any internal codes that you require in order to identify the particular page you're on, but this secret value will be different depending on the page that you've embedded the app on. We'll republish that. That'll bring up our button. You can see already that the timer has started. You can see now this secret value being presented on our app. And like I said, this is purely for demonstration. You don't need to have these two values on here. It's just to enable you to understand how this all works. And if I hit the record learning button now, Behind the scenes, if I jump onto my training and development log, you can see that I now have a learning path ID, which is the title based on Power Apps Learning. We can see that the user is myself, and it was created a few seconds ago with 19 seconds spent on that page. Now there's all sorts of other logic you'd want to apply within this Power App, for instance, disabling that button once they've clicked on it so it can't be clicked again. You could use the visible parameter so that it's hidden, and you of course wouldn't want these two controls with the text. You might also want a confirmation message to say that your learning time is now being recorded. But let's have a look at what happens when I try to access as another user. So if we load up Dave on the same page, you'll see top right here, I'm now logged on as Dave Azure. If I scroll down to the bottom, the Power App is trying to open, but currently it says it's not opening correctly, because I don't have access to the app and I need to ask the owner to share it. So if I jump back on as the app owner, and we'll need to go into Power Apps, here we can share the app. And you've got a few possibilities. Obviously this could be shared with your whole entire organization, and if it is, you could potentially use the everyone group, but equally you might want to configure something like a security group where those users that are part of this training program or require access to the app for whatever reason are part of the security group, and then you can manage that centrally. So for now, I'm going to add in everyone because it means that I know that Dave will be able to access it. I'm not going to send an invitation to everyone. We'll go ahead and share that. He will only be able to use it as a user, as you can see there. And if I jump back onto Dave's experience here on the SharePoint site and refresh that page, we should see that the Power App now runs, but it's asking for permission. Now this particular pop-up, it's only going to happen once. The first time that they use this app, they're going to be asked, are they happy with accessing SharePoint? They would have to click allow, obviously, for this to work, but there is also a PowerShell command that will override this, so your users don't have to click on allow. So in order to set up the admin consent, we can fire up a PowerShell terminal like so, and we can use this particular commandlet to bypass the consent. So there are two parameters we need to establish. The first is the environment name. The second is the app name. The environment name is rather straightforward. You can get that from the URL. So if you're in Power Automate, you can see that we have the environment name here. But also if we go into Power Apps, again, we can see the environment name here in the URL. In terms of accessing the app ID, it's actually on this screen here where we've gone into the details for the app. We have the app ID down here, which we can copy. So bringing up that PowerShell, at the moment, the end user will not be able to run that app without consenting. If I hit the play button here, it will authenticate and it will update the consent. And if I jump back onto Dave, I can hit the refresh button, and if we scroll down, we'll see that Dave no longer has to consent. So with Dave now having access to that app, if he wants to record his learning, he can hit that button, and if we bring up our data source, which is on my training development log, we'll be able to see that Dave has now recorded some time on the Power Apps learning page. And just to set the context once more, if we jump across into our data loss prevention, we can go into edit, we can add in that Power App and allow both Dave and myself to record the fact that we've attended the, or at least read the DLP. So if I grab that link like before, jump across here, paste that in, insert the ampersand and the secret value, you could call this whatever you want, and we can put in equals, and I'll call this the DLP learning. Now the great thing, remember, is at the moment we're able to display that value. If I put 123, the app will refresh. We can see we now have exclamation mark 23. There's 123. If I republish that, we can record my learning as Damien. And if I jump across onto the browser as Dave and go onto the data loss prevention page, allow that app to load, you can see that if I record my learning as Dave, if I jump back onto my learning log here, we can see that both Damien and Dave have recorded their learning against the DLP learning page. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to check out my latest videos.